for the Central Brevard Sharing Center as they prepare for Thanksgiving baskets to several families in the community. And you see those items listed there that we need, and there is a basket in our narthex if you would like to contribute. We also have a basket down the hall in the South Hall, and if you would like to place it there. And if we continue to collect items for our Nana bags, so if you would like to do that, you are welcome to do so. We have a few people added to our prayer requests this week. Kings, chapter 17, verses 8 through 16. Then the word of the Lord came to him, saying, "Go now to Zarephath, which belongs to Sidon, and live there, for I have commanded a widow there to feed you." So he set out and went to Zarephath. When he came to the gate of the town, a widow was there gathering sticks. He called to her and said, "Bring me a little water in a vessel, so that I may drink." As she was going to bring it, he called to her and said, "Bring me a morsel of bread in your hand." But she said, "As the Lord your God lives, I have nothing baked, only a handful of meal in a jar and a little oil in a jug. I am now gathering a couple of sticks, so that I may go home and prepare it for myself and my son, so that we may eat it and die." Elijah said to her, "Do not be afraid. Go and do as you have said, but first make me a little cake of it and bring it to me. And afterwards, make something for yourself and your son. For thus the Lord, the God of Israel, says, jar of meal will not be emptied, and the jug of oil will not fail until the day the Lord sends rain on the earth." She went and did as Elijah said, so that she, as well as he and her household, ate for many days. The jar of meal was not emptied, neither did the jug of oil fail, according to the word of the Lord that he had spoken by Elijah. New Testament lesson today is from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 12, verses 38 through 44. As Jesus taught, he said, "Beware of the scribes, who like to walk around in long robes and to be greeted with respect in the marketplaces, and to have the best seats in the synagogues and places of honor at banquets. They devour widows' houses, and for the sake of appearance, they say really long prayers. They will receive the greater condemnation." He sat down opposite the treasury, opposite the temple treasury, and watched a crowd putting money into the treasury. Many rich people put in large sums. A poor widow came and put in two small copper coins, which are worth about a penny. Then he called his disciples and said to them, "Truly I tell you, this poor widow has put in more than all those who are contributing to the treasury. For all of them have contributed out of their abundance, but she out of her poverty has put in everything she has. All she had to live on. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our Lord, it stands forever. This is the word of the Lord."
Thanks be to God.
I don't see any children to come forward today, so you are the children. All right, tell me what kind of posture I've got. Just shout it out. You don't have to raise your hand.
Closed.
A closed posture. All right. Now tell me what kind of posture I have.
Accepting and open.
Accepting and open. Let us pray. Dear Jesus.
Dear Jesus.
Thank you for loving us.
Thank you for loving us.
Thank you for always being with us.
Thank you for always being with us.
We're so glad. You showed us how to be open and giving. Help us to do the same.
Help us to do the same.
Amen. Well, you may be nervous about today's sermon, and I don't blame you. I was nervous even reading it myself. Who wants to hear about someone who gives everything? And he talks about that as the disciples are talking and looking around. for their need to be seen. Puffing themselves up, saying loud and long prayers, probably showing the money they're giving. Dressing in finery, taking the best seats, Jesus criticizes them. Jesus says, they do this. Why? At the same time, they take advantage of the powerless widows. The widows were the poor people in that culture. They had no recourse for income. They had nothing for income. In fact, he uses a harsh expression. The scribes devour the widows' houses. They purposefully make them destitute and homeless, in other words. Then Jesus positions himself across from the treasury, and remember that he's already made a scene in the temple just one chapter earlier. He sits across from the temple treasury, and he uses an object lesson. It teaches disciples an important truth that he wants them to remember. He likes object lessons. So he uses something that happens and he teaches them something. In contrast to the wealthy scribes who are taking advantage of poor widows, we see a poor widow give all that she has to the temple. Jesus lifts her up as an example of true discipleship. We're left wondering, are we supposed to give everything? Are we supposed to be poor? Is he lifting her up for another reason? We're left wondering if we're missing something in this passage. The harsh truth is that both the scribes and the widow woman were giving money to an institution that will be destroyed in just a few short years. Jesus has already predicted that in an earlier chapter in Mark. It's also true that the scribes and the other wealthy people were giving just a small portion of their income while the widow woman was giving her all. She reminds me of a friend of mine in the very first church I served as a pastor. Her name is Ann. She lives in Dothan. She once described her practice of tithing. Remember that tithing means giving 10% of your income off the top. She was one of those testimony people who talked about her practice. And she said she learned to tithe over the years through thick and through thin. She disciplined herself to tithe no matter what, to always give 10% of her income. And she said there were times that she really couldn't use that money. She was a widow herself. And she found that when been others who have given life to poor woman in the passage, who gave sacrificially. We thought of St. Francis of Assisi, who gave up all of his wealth, even his clothing. In fact, he did it in the courtroom as his father was trying to talk him out of it. He gave up all of his wealth, all of his clothing, in order to live in poverty as a monk. We've also thought of the famous Mother Teresa, living in the poverty-stricken streets of Calcutta, India. To give sacrificially, like the widow woman in the story, means stripping oneself of the attachments that hold us closed and captive and keep us from living freely in God's love and mercy. Are you willing to do, as Jesus advised the rich young ruler a few weeks ago, and sell all of your possessions and give all of your possessions to the poor? Not many of us are willing to give that sacrificially. And most of us strive each day to also not be like the scribes, whose motivation is self-serving. I suspect we're somewhere in the middle. Jesus gives of the poor widow. What can we learn from the example of the poor widow and of the scribes? What is Jesus trying to tell us individually and corporately? One of the things our study group decided is that the institution does bear some responsibility to this poor widow. She gives out of her heart, she is extravagantly generous, and she trusts in the one who loves her beyond measure. And the institution, the church, the temple in that day, is the hands and feet of God in caring for her and the other poor in our midst. Her gift, all by itself, may not change the world, we decided, but her heart certainly could, if people had the ears to hear and the eyes to see. Because her gift includes trust, and trust leads to open fists, and open fists lead to gratitude and real compassion for others. And let's face it, real compassion changes things. It changes the lives of those receiving compassion, and it changes the life of the one giving compassion. And that's what the church is to be about. After all, changing lives. I've been stewing over this passage this week, knowing that Pledge Sunday is soon, and we're reading about a poor widow who gives everything to an institution that's dying. A few years ago, believe it or not, Mike does help me with sermons, but a few years ago, Mike helped me reframe this particular passage. He reminded me that it was not the faith and the faith community that died in the year 70 when the temple was destroyed. It's the faith, and faith community didn't die, it changed. There's a difference between dying and changing. The temple may have been destroyed that year by the Romans, but the Jewish faith and its worship did not die, it changed. As a result, more local synagogues were developed, and the sacrificial system evolved, no longer slaughtering animals. The sacrificial system changed. God did not die, and the Jewish faith did not die, but it did change. For years now, people have expressed worry and fear about the changes we see happening in the larger church right here and right now. Not just in the Presbyterian denomination, but in all denominations, people describe worrying trends: aging populations, decreased giving, younger generations who are hesitant to make commitments to an institution that they see is really out of touch. Some have wondered aloud if the church is dying or no longer will look like in 20 to 30 years from now, I do not know. But I do know this. God is not dead. Jesus is not dead. And God still calls us to be together in community, to sing songs of gratitude and trust, and to give to others and help them change their lives, regardless of the circumstance that we find ourselves, in which we find ourselves. We are to continue to be together, sing songs of gratitude and trust, give to others, regardless of our circumstance. Today's Old Testament passage is another example of a poor person doing an extravagant thing. Trusting in God's mercy to accomplish what is needed, she listened to the prophet Elijah, and she chose to show hospitality to him even when she only had one meal left for her and her son. And because of her trust and her faithfulness, God made her a rich woman with several houses, a brand new yacht, and tax breaks that she could claim. Right? Isn't that what it said? No. Contrary to what you might hear with the prosperity gospel preachers, God never promises riches if you are faithful. God promises to be present with you through thick and thin, through times of prosperity and through times of poverty. God will not leave you. The widow woman was given what she and her family needed, not wealth and recognition. There is no gospel that claims prosperity for the faithful. Rockledge Presbyterian is in a good place, and we're here, I think, at the right time. We are not large, but we are blessed with resources. We are blessed with some savings and people who open their hands and their heart to pledge their support of the church's mission and ministry. We cannot do mission and ministry without you. In a couple of weeks, you'll hear about our plans for 2022, for next year. Yes, we will be into a new year before we know it. And we pray that once you hear those plans, you'll give it some thought and prayer, that you will respond with a pledge of gratitude as we choose to minister together into the future. The amount you pledge is, well, it's up to you, God, right? It is a mark of discipleship, just like Bible study, just like prayer, just like giving to others, helping others. Giving is a mark of discipleship. Rockledge Presbyterian is blessed with diversity. There is all kinds of opinions in this place. We are blessed with a diversity of opinions, a diversity of income, a diversity of backgrounds. We are blessed with diversity, and we enjoy working together toward a common goal of growing in Christ through worship and service. If we're going to make a show of anything, let it be a show of God's mercy and generosity in the community around us. And I believe then we can give God the glory. Amen.
Please rise. Let us confess the faith of our baptism using the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried.
You may be seated. Communion will be celebrated by movement today. Here in the sanctuary, you will come forward by the center aisle where you will receive bread on both sides. This side will come this way, and this side will come this way. You will receive bread from the first person. You will consume it. Then you will go to the second person, which will be closer to the baskets over there on both sides. And when you consume the juice, you will place the cup in the basket and return to your seat by the side aisle. Those of you who are at home, please secure your elements of bread and wine or juice at this time. My friends, this is not a Presbyterian table. It is the Lord's table, and you are all invited to this table. It demonstrates Jesus' abundant grace that is poured out for each one of us. God calls us from east and from west, from north and from south, those who have gone before us and those who are coming after us, and all of us here today and at home. God calls us all to taste and see that the Lord is indeed good. God, this table is a sign for us that points to God's grace, unity, and peace. It is meant to stir us from complacency and get us moving. We are reminded that love will win over fear, you the yes at this table with a simple loaf and cup. Here you transform us by the working of your wondrous love to be Christ's body in the world. Send us from this place out into your broken and beautiful world to bear your good news of hope and joy for all. This we pray in your holy name. Amen. Let us sing verses 3 and 4 of our communion hymn, hymn number 347. Way back up front, you may do so. Please. indeed yours. You created us, and we are yours. We confess that we forget that sometimes, and we have difficulty opening ourselves up for your love and grace in our lives. Many times we prefer to do things our way and go our own path. Forgive us. Correct us gently, we pray, and put us back on the right path. We ask for your love and mercy all of our days. We ask today for your love and healing mercies for Tom and for Lita, and for continued healing for Sherry and Daria and Janet and Dick. We lift to you Max and Jeffrey and Larry, and we lift to you Eric, who's able to be with us today. We ask your healing mercies, your grace, your love surround all of them, and the ones who are near and dear to us in our hearts, that we lift to you now silently. We are grateful that you do not give up on us, that you continue to call us forward, and you continue showing us what it means to open our lives to your love and grace. We are grateful. Now hear us as we pray.